Next topic is the diabetes and hypertension, which I shall be trying to finish in next 15 minutes. And although concept has been a lot changed, but before I start my talk, I must congratulate Dr. Banshee Saboo and team, not only for leading us in the diabetes across the country, but also organizing a very successful DiaCareCon again this year, 2021, despite having the COVID challenges. So diabetes and hypertension, as we all know, that diabetes and hypertension shares the common soil. Many complications are the same in both the diseases. And more interesting, hypertension is more common in individuals who are having diabetes as compared to the general population. Especially in the diabetic patient, it is remaining there in 40 to 80% of the prevalence of hypertension. So when hypertension and diabetes both are existing together, we get more heart attack, 3 times likely to have coronary heart disease, 2x likely to have left ventricular hypertension, and 3x likely to have the cardiac failure. More of the microvascular complications, like more chances of getting retinopathy, nephropathy, peripheral vascular disease, and of course the strokes also. As far as the diabetes and hypertension spectrum in India is concerned, it is actually the example of the unity in diversity, what we really expect across the India. We don't find any change in the prevalence of hypertension and its associated risk factors when it is occurring together with the diabetes across the India. Almost all parts of the India are behaving in the similar fashion. Crude prevalence of the diabetes is 7.5% in India, although hypertension is having the prevalence of 25.3%. But it is 3x more prevalent than diabetes, but it still attracts less attention of the healthcare workers as well as the industry. What we call of the putative mechanism whereby diabetes and hypertension cause vascular disease together. As I already said, the insulin resistance always remains in the root. But when these diseases are occurring together, they join hands while causing hyperglycemia, which causes accumulated glycemic end products again and again and leading to microvascular and macrovascular incidences more and more. Apart from this hyperglycemia, about which we all know, there are more mechanism of actions like RAS, like immune activation. RAS means renin angiotensin aldosterone system, oxidative stress, inflammation, and messenger RNA. All they contribute in causing macrovascular and microvascular complication. As I already said, that diabetes and hypertension remains together. It is not 1+1 is equal to 2, but it is 1+1 is equal to 3. So what we know is diabetes approximately doubles the cardiovascular disease risk factor risk in patients, those who are having the hypertension, may it be cardiovascular events, may it be stroke, may it be MI, may it be mortality, or any kind of the cardiovascular events. We already know that common risk factors works to give the mortality so 3x in a patient, those who are having diabetes and hypertension. But what are those common risk factors? Genetics, we don't change that. But the other 3 common risk factors like insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, and obesity, these are the combination of the genetic and environmental factors where we can definitely avoid and stop the environmental factors up to the respectable limit and causing the prevention of these combination or combo diseases together. When these 2 diseases are occurring together, they help in causation of the atherosclerosis by promoting the deposition of cholesterol under the arterial wall, endothelial dysfunction, vascular inflammation. In fact, the endothelial dysfunction starts 15 years before the diagnosis of the diabetes in a diabetic patient. So you just imagine if both these diseases are occurring together, what will happen to the endothelial dysfunction, because both are independently capable enough to cause the endothelial dysfunction. Vascular inflammation, fibrosis, arterial remodeling, and all these things when they are together, of course, they end up in the microvascular and macrovascular cardiovascular adverse outcomes. As far as the phenotypic characteristic which is associated with occurrence of hypertension in patients with type 2 diabetes, very interestingly, more commonly seen in the male. Of course, the familial tendency is more important in occurrence of the hypertension in diabetic patients. Many of the diabetic patients you must have seen, they are having the diabetes for 20 years or 25 years, but they don't have the hypertension. So these are the important things which makes the characteristic association of hypertension with the type 2 diabetes. With increasing age, it increases in the diabetes also as well as in non-diabetics too. With increasing BMI, it increases. With increasing duration of the diabetes, it increases. With reduction, the eGFR, it increases. Microalbuminuria and macroalbuminuria are the things which increases with the hypertension, as well as hypertension also increases with the increase in the albumin in urine. Retinopathy is another association with the hypertension, which increases with the increasing hypertension, of course, the myocardial infarction and stroke too. BP characteristics in diabetes patients are very complex, which does not allow us to get it better controlled. Patient, those who are having the diabetes, more commonly they have isolated systolic hypertension, posing a challenge to control that systolic hypertension, because whenever you try to control the systolic hypertension, the isolated blood pressure further goes down. These patients have enhanced variability in blood pressure, prone to develop orthostatic hypotension, have hypertension which is more resistant to the treatment, experience less reduction in the nocturnal BP, and higher baseline heart rates than non-diabetic counterparts. So this is a very specific thing to diabetic patient, that they lost the nocturnal dipping. And this happens because of the autonomic neuropathy. Blood pressure controls in these patients presents a great challenge, because the target blood pressure is quite low and the response to treatment is often poor in diabetic patients whenever we try to control it. And many of the times the window of the control is so narrow, it does not work really to reduce the or keep the blood pressure in that particular window, which ranges for the systolic between 110 to 130. So whenever we try to reduce the blood pressure in a diabetic patient, the macrovascular complications reduces definitely. Diabetic patient develop cardiovascular disease at 2 to 3 folds the rate observed in the non-diabetic patient. But hypertension as a complication in a diabetic patient increases the frequency of developing CVD by 2 to 3 folds. Compared to normotensive non-diabetics, the rate of onset of the CVD is 5 to 7 times higher in diabetic patient. Hypertension, especially the systolic hypertension, is strongly and directly related to stroke in all age groups. The presence of diabetes more than doubles the risk of stroke in patients with hypertension. Lowering blood pressure in patients with hypertension and diabetes reduces the risk of stroke by 44%. Diabetes is a salt-sensitive hypertension. It is believed to have it with high glomerular blood pressure and a flatter pressure diuresis curve. Hyperinsulinemia is one of the important reasons which is behind this salt sensitivity of the hypertension. Excessive salt intake inhibits the nocturnal blood pressure reduction. Many of the times people, those who eat in the night times, especially the salty products, they also contribute in non-dipping of their hypertension. A standardized association of the 10 mm of the mercury drop in the systolic blood pressure with all-cause mortality and macro and microvascular outcomes in type 2 diabetes. So 10 mm of mercury also makes the wonder if we can able to reduce it. Morning hypertension has significantly high frequency of developing nephropathy and retinopathy, so that we have to be really worried about the morning hypertension more as compared to the hypertension at any other time in the day. Frequency of the development of cerebrovascular disorder also gets higher and higher in the patient, those who develop the morning hypertension. And always remember, this morning hypertension is more common in the diabetic individuals. Circadian rhythm also plays a very important role in the diabetic patients regarding their blood pressure. So 24 hours ambulatory blood pressure monitoring is more convenient and more useful in diabetic patients. Higher awake and sleep systolic blood pressure predicts increased risk of the cardiovascular events more accurately than the clinic blood pressure in diabetic as well as non-diabetic individuals. The incidence of the cardiovascular events in non-dippers was similar in dippers, but risers showed the highest risk of the cardiovascular event in both groups, the hazard ratio of which was 2.39 and 2.55 respectively. We know that ACE inhibitors is the drug which is to be initiated for the treatment in hypertensive, especially if the person is diabetic also. patient having the diabetes and hypertension together, no replacement of the ACE inhibitors or ARBs, what we call it, the RAS blockers, should be preferred with any other agent to initiate with the treatment because of the albuminuria benefits. We get reduce the albuminuria if we start timely RAS blockers in patient with hypertension. More intensive blood pressure lowering improves cardiovascular outcome irrespective of baseline systolic blood pressure and atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Mortality and cardiovascular outcomes with RAS inhibitors, when it has been compared with calcium channel blockers, in patients with diabetes, we found that RAS blocker had a definite edge over its counterparts of the calcium channel blockers in almost all cause of the concern, all complications, may it be all-cause mortality, may it be cardiovascular mortality, MI, angina, stroke, heart failure. When it has been compared with diuretics, it was having a clear-cut edge as compared to the diuretics in the RAS inhibitors, and RAS inhibitors found to be more beneficial in diabetic patients. You know that diuretic is also having the tendency to increase the glucose level. Mortality and cardiovascular outcome with RAS inhibitors has been compared with the beta blockers, and we all know that RAS inhibitors have been found to be more beneficial as compared to the beta blockers as far as the blood pressure reduction in diabetic patients are concerned. Hypoglycemia also plays an important role in causing hypertension and arrhythmia both in diabetic patients. Very unlikely we have our attention over the impending hypoglycemia. Many a times it keeps on occurring without our knowledge also, and many a times our diabetic patients comes up with the high blood pressure, which is the sporadic high blood pressure, and we never measure their blood pressure, blood sugar level at that time. Sometimes they may be having the hypoglycemia or nearby to hypoglycemia at that time. So arrhythmia also frequently occurs during asymptomatic hypoglycemic period. Arrhythmia during hypoglycemia likely reason for increase in cardiovascular death observed in during strict blood glucose control. So many of the times now it is a fashion of a strict blood glucose control, and strict blood glucose control leads to the arrhythmia as well as hypertension, and hypoglycemia mortality rate is reported to be 10%, which is also called the dead in bed syndrome, and relative risk of the CVD occurring during serious hypoglycemia is reported to 2.054. There are reports and there are studies which shows that blood pressure drops with improvement in hyperglycemia. Many of the time patient comes with diabetes and blood pressure uncontrolled together, but we see that as much as we reduce the glucose level, as well as we reduce the glucose level up to the optimum level, we get the blood pressure normal. And many of the anti-glycemic drugs also have their impact on the hypertension. Like metformin, pioglitazone, which improve insulin resistance, are reported to have slight hypotensive action. Some recent anti-glycemic drugs, which have been found to be more predominantly working on the blood pressure, like GLP-1 receptor agonists, like SGLT2 inhibitors, because of their diuretic effects and sodium excretory mechanism, which helps in causing blood pressure lowering as compared together with the glucose lowering. The beneficial effects of the SGLT2 inhibitors, apart from decreased glycated hemoglobin, apart from reducing HbA1c, they have got the beneficial effects on the LDL cholesterol, triglyceride. They improve the HDL cholesterol, decrease the oxidative stress, decrease the sympathetic nervous system activation, decrease ventricular arrhythmia, they decrease the inflammation, arterial for treatment of hypertension, especially in the patient with type 2 diabetes. Whenever we are coming across a patient with the type 2 diabetes, we see that blood pressure, if it is less than 140/90, we should start doing the diet and exercise practices without any drug, whether it is required or not. And we try to keep it less than 130/80 in all possible efforts of. But if it is between 140/90 and 160/100, of course, the monotherapy is the need. and albuminuria is there, then definitely it is to be initiated with the RAS blockers, maybe ACE inhibitors or ARB, depending upon the level of blood pressure. If the blood pressure is mild, ACE inhibitor will definitely work, but if it is not, then ARBs works better. Blood pressure, if it is more than 160 by 100, then dual therapy is the choice. If it is associated with albuminuria, then dual therapy must contain the ACE inhibitor at least. But if it is not, then you can choose any two drugs, and then you may step forward for the triple therapy also if it does not give good control. If the patient is having the myocardial infarction, you can choose any drugs except the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. In resistant hypertension, you are open to choose any group of the antihypertensive medications. What does the ADA say in 2020? Guidelines. ADA says that for individuals with diabetes and hypertension at higher cardiovascular risk, having atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease risk at least 15% or 10-year atherosclerotic risk is 15% or less than 130/80. So here at this point of the time, ADA is in the accordance of the ACC and AHA if it can be safely attained. For individuals with diabetes and hypertension at lower risk of the cardiovascular disease, like 10-year atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease risk is less than 15%, treat to a blood pressure target of less than 140/90. In pregnant patient with diabetes and pre-existing hypertension, a blood pressure target of less than or equal to 135/85 is suggested in the interest of reducing the risk for accelerated maternal hypertension and minimizing the impaired fetal growth together. So ADA suggests if your patient is having the blood pressure between 140/90 and 160/100, start one agent together with the lifestyle management. If the person is having albuminuria, one of that agent should be the RAS blocker. If it is not, then you are open to choose any of the three or four medications as per the patient's needs of you. If the patient is having the 160 by 100 blood pressure or more than that, then dual therapy should be initiated. If patient is associated with albuminuria, still the patient gets not good control or he's having the adverse effects, then you must add the mineralocorticoid receptors antagonist, and following that you can send the patient to the expert for the blood pressure. So points to ponder at the end: for patient with blood pressure more than 120/80 mm of mercury, risk starts increasing, especially when the patient is having type 2 diabetes. The lifestyle intervention consists of weight loss. If overweight or obese, a dietary approach or DASH diet must be started in such patient, reducing sodium and increasing the potassium intake. Moderation of alcohol intake, increasing physical activity are the cornerstone of the therapy. So whenever your diabetic patient is increasing or going beyond 120/80, it is the time to start the treatment in the lifestyle modification. Patient with confirmed office blood pressure more than 140/90 should adopt lifestyle therapy and have prompt initiation and timely titration of the pharmacological therapy to achieve the goals. Goal should be the 130/80. One patient with confirmed office blood pressure equivalent to or more than 160/100 should adopt lifestyle and timely titration of the two drugs or a single pill combination of that dual drug. It has demonstrated to reduce the CV events in patients with diabetes. And ACE inhibitors or ARB at the maximum tolerated dose indicated for BP treatment. The recommended first line treatment for hypertension in patients with diabetes and those who are having urinary albumin creatinine ratio 300 or more than that. If one class is not tolerated, that another class should be substituted. For patient treated with an ACE inhibitor, ARB or diuretic, serum creatinine or EGFR and serum potassium levels should be monitored at least once in a year. Selection of anti-glycemic drugs also play important role, not only in hypertension management, but also in cardiovascular risk reduction in patients, those who are having type 2 diabetes. So always choose wisely the anti-glycemic drugs to treat the diabetes also. People with high blood pressure diabetes, those are conditions brought about by lifestyle. If you change the lifestyle, those conditions will leave. This thing should always be kept remembered by us, as well as must we keep reminding our patients also all the time. Thank you very much for your kind listening.